Hey, welcome to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing. I'm Don Maeda. Today I'm joined by Troy Lee Designs Red Bull KTM rider Derek Drake. So, buddy, thanks for coming on the show.
No problem. Glad to be here. For sure, impressive setup you got.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, we tried to actually get you on the last time, and you called me the day of the show and said that you broke your hand at Fox Raceway, right?
Yeah, had a small little fracture. No big deal, but we're back riding now, and we'll be good to go.
Nice. All right, so you made your, you know, quote-unquote pro debut last year in the Nationals, but your big Supercross debut was this year, and I mean, I believe you got eighth at Anaheim Run, right?
Yeah,
so correct. Eighth at your first ever Supercross, that's badass. Were you pleased with your rookie debut?
Yeah, I was like, it felt really good all day, and like, I didn't feel anything was too out of whack. Everything went really smooth, practice was smooth, and I was flowing and stuff, and then got a decent start in the main, and I rode by my teammate Brandon for the whole main event. I was just, all right, we're in eighth, and first one, let's get out of the way and move on.
Yeah. Was it a difficult transition getting ready for Supercross? I mean, because you obviously ride motocross your whole life, but it seems like these days with the, you know, the Monster Cup, the amateur all-stars and everything, a lot of kids ride Supercross early. Was that the case for you, or was it something all new?
Yeah, I've had some Supercross experience for sure. I did Monster Cup once on Super Mini, twice on the Big Bike All-Star class, and I felt pretty comfortable, but it's different. You're preparing for one race for the Monster Cup, and you're preparing for a whole season when you turn pro. So definitely a lot more laps put in and a lot more time and testing and effort put into the whole Supercross season. But it was good. I mean, it always gets tough, but you push through it and works out in the end.
Yeah. I got to see you quite a few times in the off season, you know, testing at the Troy Lee KTM track in Corona. Quite often the whole team was there. Is it easy to test and train and build your speed up with your teammates there, or is it better alone, you think?
Definitely. I like and don't like having other people around, but it pushes you to be your best. When you're alone, you just ride in your comfort zone and you don't really get better. So you have to have your teammates there to push you, and it's pretty much just stopwatch nationals every day. Who's got the best lap time, who does best through here. So it gets exhausting, but in the end, it makes you a better rider.
One day I was there, and Tyler was letting Tickle ride there because he was on the Husky.
Yeah.
And I remember Brandon Hartraff was struggling in the whoops.
Yeah.
And Tyler was like, you know, telling about some technique, and then got Tickle over to talk to him. And then Brandon kept doing it, and eventually Tickle got on Brandon's bike to do it. But like, was there anything on the track that was like that for you, where the team had to work with you and teach you?
I'm trying to think. The whoops in the beginning, I struggled with in the Murrieta test track. They're a lot bigger, and they're so peaky and just a little slick and sketchy. But I struggled there for some reason. I didn't really struggle in the whoops at the Corona test track, but it was always the Murrieta one where I struggled, and where Tyler had a Tyler and I took some time to figure it out and get through it. But like to say I'm pretty good at them now, but sometimes they come at you really quick and grab you.
Yeah. All right, so that Red Bull Moto Spy was pretty gnarly when Tyler's just like ripping on Brandon.
Yeah.
Was that like staged, or is he really like that, and has he gone off on you like that?
No, that was definitely not staged. For me, that day I had a really good day.
Yeah,
and then
you escaped the wrath.
Yeah, so I was out of it, and I had a really good day, solid day, and I was in and out. Brandon, I mean, he was struggling with, he was mentally struggling at the moment because it was right in the middle of our boot camp. A lot of pressure, A1's coming, and all these variables were coming in, and he just struggled that day. But usually he's on par every day that I ride with him, he's pretty good, so. Yeah, that day the cameras were there, and they caught everything. So, like I said, it was a good day for me. So I got out of there quick.
Yeah. Hey, the Murrieta test track, it's pretty crazy, huh? That where it is, like in the middle of the city, and it's so impressive when you're there, just because it's kind of on the elevated pad above everything else. It feels like you're on the moon, you know. And then it's like the dedicated like paved parking and the permanent shade structures and stuff. it's kind of surreal. That's like such a pro setup. And it's this track specifically for the Husky and KTM teams.
Yeah, I think about that every time I drive up there. I'm like, wow, like, I'm pretty fortunate. I got these two tracks right here, full, like, water system. Just, you can do it off your phone, and you got like full legit bathrooms. You got the shade set up. Mm-hmm. I mean, full dedicated parking, like you said, and the tracks are awesome. I love them, and I mean, I'm grateful every time I show up.
So there's a Husky track and a KTM track, but can you
ride? Yeah, we ride during the week. We'll usually ride the front one, and then Thursday, Friday, we'll ride the back one. And then one day we might ride the Corona one. So we got three tracks that we switch back and forth on. So we're lucky.
And then there's an enduro cross track up there, right?
Yeah.
Have you ever gone out there and?
No, I look at it sometimes when we're on the back track, and I look at it, I'm like, wow, like,
dude, how do they jump from like a log to a log? The stuff they do is kind of gnarly, right?
Yeah, it's definitely so gnarly.
So of the three tracks, which is the most like legit, like real racetrack style?
The Corona one's more it's mellower for sure, mm-hmm. more high speed and intensity type deal. But the two Marietta ones are for sure legit. I like the back one. It's got a little bit darker dirt, and mm-hmm. It's pretty tacky, and the rhythms are pretty similar to what I would say on race day, but nothing ever compares to a race day track, I feel like. When mm-hmm. you go to the stadium, it's bigger, it's wider, and you got tough blocks, and it's just, it's different once you get there, but they do a pretty good job of replicating it for sure. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you're based out here still in Southern California. Mm-hmm. I thought everybody involved in that program had to go train with Alden back east.
Yeah, the deal was, like, I still get my programs directly from Alden, mm-hmm. and Alden's obviously the main guy, and then we got two trainers, Seth and Mike, mm-hmm. and so they kind of split their time, so Seth will be out here in California, Mike will be in Florida for, mm-hmm. like, the Husky guys, like RJ and Michael, and Seth will be out here with us with Brandon, Pierce, and I, mm-hmm. and, yeah, so they kind of split our time, and, we do our work.
Yeah. What is the team dynamic like? I mean, it's you, Brandon, and Pierce Brown. Mm-hmm. Obviously, Brian Moreau's injured. But like, say, before Brian got hurt, was it pretty good? Did you guys get along well?
Yeah, we got along really well. Like, Brian, Pierce, Brandon, and I, we were all super tight, and we all got lunch together and went to the gym together, did our bike rides together, and we definitely created a good relationship with all of us, mm-hmm. and it was all good. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so when Brandon was here, I always tease him about like how big and burly he is, mm-hmm. and he's all, dude, I swear, when I go to the gym, I work out like 15-pound weights. Mm-hmm. Is he telling the truth, or is he throwing up like plates and plates?
No, he's telling the truth. I mean, obviously a couple stuff he's got me beat on weights with like the machines, but it's all pretty mellow and 15-20 pound weights at the gym. Mm-hmm. But yeah, he's telling the truth.
That's crazy. So I think, were you with Brandon and Brian the day I saw you guys at Skyline?
Yeah.
Okay, so like, were you guys all on Turbo Levos then? Or I know Brandon was, right?
Possibly, yeah.
Okay, so Alden really mm-hmm. loves and embraces the specialized Turbo Levo, like pedal assist bike.
Yeah.
How do you feel about that for training?
I personally love it. Like, I wake in the morning and sound like, dang it, mountain bike ride. But like, I hop on that thing and like, I can look at what zones he told me to be in that day, and mm-hmm. I can bump it down, bump it up, and keep it right in that sweet spot.
So you adjust the mm-hmm. amount of assist to keep your heart mm-hmm. rate in a certain mm-hmm. zone.
Yeah. So, I mean, we're not like redlining or anything, but we're right in that zone where we're supposed to be in. And I love him because the tires are wider. It's got like a more planted feel, like mm-hmm. coming down, like you're way more planted than a...
And it's got a lot of suspension, right?
Huge, like good suspension. It's definitely safer for coming down. Like, I've ridden my normal one, and it's light, it's just super light, super just edgy and just slick, and like,
yeah,
give me on back of my turbo, like it's just planted and you can roll the corners. It's way more fun.
Yeah, the weight sometimes mm-hmm. makes it more controllable, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Like, I when motocross guys, you know, they train on these like hardtails or mm-hmm. like slow travel cross-country bikes, that's great for going really fast, right? But mm-hmm. like, sometimes I think a bike with more suspension is actually safer, because I mean, mm-hmm. we've had guys like Chase Sexton crash because he was riding a cross-country bike.
Yeah.
I always wondered about the turbo thing though. Like, I mean, when I ride a pedal assist, I put that thing on turbo.
Yeah, yeah, just for fun. Have
fun, right?
Yeah.
But you guys are actually riding it in the lowest setting.
And yeah, definitely. Like most of the time we're on the lowest setting and we're still going way faster than we would be on a normal bicycle. It's way more fun. We're definitely go farther and higher, go to places that we never would have gone on a normal bike within our bike rides are hour and a half, sometimes two. So like Skyline, we'll go forever and just see places that we never would have seen if we were on a normal bike. So it's definitely a lot more fun.
Yeah, Zach told me that sometimes in Florida, Alden makes him ride it on the street turned off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like that's what, sometimes I do that on like, I had a mountain bike ride yesterday and I was on the street and I'm like, I need to get my heart rate higher. So I just turned it off and the thing is heavy.
Yeah.
So you just turn it off and just crank it out and on the road before you get to the trail and bumps up your heart rate and trainer's happy.
Oh man. All right, Derek, we're gonna take a quick break here from our sponsors, but we'll be back for more. Hey, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing. Joined by Troy Lee, Red Bull KTM's Derek Drake. And buddy, you're from Central California, right? San Luis Obispo, mm-hmm. I think?
Yeah, San Luis Obispo, right on the coast.
Okay, so that's not exactly the hotbed of motocross. Like, how did you become a moto rider?
Basically, my dad got me a motorcycle on my third birthday, and I rode around the house and ran into the side of the garage a couple times, and then we started. My dad had a couple good friends, and we would go out and trail ride, and I would come with. So I'll just go out and trail ride on my 50, and just have fun out in the desert and out in the hills.
Was there much of a racing scene up there? I mean, I think there was the Paso Robles Raceway, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah, there was a couple fairground races close by, but that all kind of faded out. So we had to go to the valley, like Central Valley, about like Madera and Hanford mm-hmm. and Tulare. That's where really the races were back in like 05-ish, 07, 08. Mm-hmm. And it was pretty big, the CMA races. And that's where I went every weekend. We raced every weekend and eventually started coming down here, down south, and racing Paris and Milestone and all those races. So, yeah, it just gradually grew.
Yeah. Yeah, I think we talked about this before, but like, that's the area where you're from is kind of like the hotbed for motorcycle flat track.
Right? Mm-hmm.
It's like you never dabbled in that or never tempted to try flat
track? No, I still this day I've never done flat track. Mm-hmm. I would like to do it, it looks fun, but it's always moto.
Yeah. And then Jesse Nelson's also from that same area. Mm-hmm. Were you guys buddies when you both lived up there?
Or? Yeah.
He's a little older
than me. Yeah, he's a little older than me. So, like, he was racing 80s, but I was on 50s. And, mm-hmm. I mean, everyone knew him. So, it was like, Jesse Nelson, like, I was kind of scared to talk to him. But, we saw each other a lot at the races out in mm-hmm. Hanford and the Valley. And we kind of did the same old thing.
Yeah. And then, eventually, you ended up living with him mm-hmm. at his home in Lake Elsinore for a little while when you first moved down, right?
Yeah, that was great. Forever thankful for Jesse and Emily for giving me, a room up there to live in and train and just put in some work down here.
Yeah. Okay. So by the time you moved in, Jesse was already injured, right?
Yeah.
was he a good source of advice and guidance? You know, I know he has his ups and downs sometimes, but like, was he pretty positive influence on your racing?
Yeah, definitely. I would say a huge positive influence for me, for sure. I mean, honestly, like, we didn't really talk about racing that much. He, like, we just kind of did our fun stuff together. And I mean, we did for sure, but it was really more about fun and hanging out and just being buddies.
Yeah. Does he really drive his UTV from his house all the way down to near the freeway where the flowers were?
We for sure done that quite a few times. I mean, the road he's on is not that busy, and there's trails left and right, so you just hop on a trail and ride close to the freeway and go under the bridge and you're right there. So
yeah,
definitely pretty good spot to have fun.
Yeah, so those rains, the big rains we had two winters ago, you know, when it rains in Southern California that much, we get that dang California poppy that pops up. So like right at your exit is where those fields were. It was a nightmare for you guys, right?
Yeah, definitely a lot of traffic for sure. I was right there. A little bit of a nightmare to go through sometimes, but all in all, it wasn't that bad.
I told him, you got to take your razor out there and just do donuts and blow the poppies out.
Oh, these California people be all over you for doing that.
Yeah, right? So you moved out of Jesse's and you bought your own place then, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, so like it's yours.
Yeah.
Okay, so a 20-year-old kid owns a house in Canyon Hills.
Yeah.
I mean, that's pretty badass, right? Like, I didn't buy my first house till I was 30, I think, but motocross has been very good for you, though.
Yeah, motocross, I'm forever grateful for the team I'm on, Troy Design Triple KTM. I mean, I've been with them since I was, I just turned 16, and I signed with them right after Loretta's. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I was on their amateur program for three years. Schoolboy 1, 250B, and then 250A, and then now we're here in the pro ranks, so I'm forever grateful for them, and it's been an awesome team. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so do you live by yourself, or do you have roommates, or?
Yeah, I have a roommate, and then I live with my girlfriend.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Nice. All right, so 8th at the first race, you've had some good showings. We're on that long break right now.
Yeah.
What are your goals to finish out the last four rounds?
The first couple rounds I've been good. A little bit up and down, just with my starts and the places I put myself in are not the greatest for the main events. But I'm looking for a goal for sure. Would be a top five to end it out and head into outdoors.
Yeah. So Seattle is what, like 4 weeks away? 4 weeks away still?
Three weeks away.
Yeah. At what point do you stop riding moto and get back into Supercross? Is it just like a couple days Supercross to get back into it, or do you think you need more than that?
No. We're gonna finish out this week on outdoors, and then next week we'll be Supercross again.
Oh, nice. What do you prefer?
At first, it was for sure motocross. I'm like, Supercross is sketchy. Supercross is not like. So gnarly, but now I've been racing it. I've had like five or six races under my belt, and for now, like I prefer Supercross for sure. Like it's a lot. It's way better than I expected, and way more fun than I expected for sure.
Yeah, I think I may have asked you this previously, but like you're on the Troy Lee team, right? Mm-hmm. Like, Troy Lee is such an icon in moto, and like I can remember going to his shop used to be in this airplane hangar in Corona, and like I saved my money and I went there, and I actually bought a gift certificate for a paint job for my older brother for his birthday, and I was like, oh, that's actually Troy Lee and stuff. But I mean, how sick is it to ride for Troy Lee's team, and how much do you get to interact with him?
Yeah, Troy's an awesome guy. I was actually with him this last weekend at the NASCAR race, I was just hanging around the pits of the NASCAR race, and then I ran into him. I didn't know he was there. I was like, oh, what's up, Troy? He's like, oh, what's up? And then I had my buddy with me. He's like, hey, like, why don't you guys come in the suite with us? I'm like, what? I'm like, you got a suite here? He's like, yeah. So he gave us these two red tickets, and we hung out in the suite and watched the race, and it was a great time. Just like, and it's just like instances like that. Like, he's an awesome dude and would do, I mean, pretty much anything for you. So definitely good to have him around.
Yeah. And then obviously the heart of the Troy brand is the gear.
Yeah.
In the helmet painting and everything. Mm-hmm. You always look super dialed. Like, do you ever go into that office where, like, they plan out what you're going to wear at every race, like, a year ahead or practically, you know? Like, you ever go in there and look at that wall and think, oh, I can't wait to wear that at this race?
Yeah, you're exactly right. Sometimes I go in there and then I see Max and we hang out and stuff. And then I'll see Troy and then be like, hey, come up here and what do you think? And he's got this whole wall and all these ideas and just drawing boards and all, like, sets of gear, like, I mean, you probably won't see, but he's got a lot, lots and lots of sets of gear up there and just waiting to, I mean, I guess just the right time to drop it. But yeah, I see some gear, I'm like, oh, like, I can't wait to wear that. Like, that stuff's sick. And yeah, it's awesome to see it come to real life when we wear it in Supercross, and we always look dialed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you ever seen Troy actually hand paint something?
No, I haven't. So badass. Yeah, I've seen pictures and videos, but I've never seen it live.
Yeah, when he pinstripes, it's crazy. Like, you know, he dips the paint, the brush in the paint, and he's using his hands and getting his hands all covered in paint to make the right point and
stuff. Yeah,
but it's such a talent. It's like it's enjoyable for me to watch him do.
Yeah, that. I'm no good at arts and crafts. I'm not good, definitely.
Okay, so has there been a kit that you're like exceptionally pumped on wearing, like the way it looked? And on the other side, has there been one where you're like, ah?
No, I mean, I remember one of the ones that was pretty controversial was the polka dot kit. I mean, but once it has all of its logos and all of its logos and your number on the back, it doesn't look that bad, but I'm like, oh, it's not that bad. But definitely, like, the San Diego kit and helmet was awesome. A2 is sick. And also Glendale with the green, black, and like the desert helmet he had is, I mean, every round I go to, like, I see my helmet and I'm like, dude, that's so sick. Can't we take it home?
Do you get to keep the helmets or do they take them back?
Yeah, most of the time you get to keep your helmets, but if there's an important, like, oh, this has to go to a sponsor or whatever, like, they'll take it. But most of the time we get to keep them. So I got a bunch in my garage all hung up. And
oh, I bet. Oh, it's just along the ceiling. Yeah. Nice. Well, hey, let's take another quick break to hear from our sponsors. We'll be back for one last segment with Derek.
Don't try to be the fastest on the track.
Be the fastest ever. Work harder than everyone else.
Because dedication is everything.
If they say your goals are crazy, be insane.
Be fast.
Be the crazy one.
Be unstoppable.
One goal, one vision.
We have four colors right now. Retails for $28.95 at odigrips.com and, of course, your favorite retailer.
We put our heads together to both reimagine and lift the bar on what a modern motocross helmet should be. Opt for the highest level of modern technology and energy dispersion with the Fly Racing Formula helmet, designed for an elevated defense against a wider range of real-world impact scenarios. Globally engineered with the most advanced materials and technologies available. Outfit yourself with proven technology, lightweight performance, and elevated impact management with the Fly Racing Formula helmet.
What's up, guys? It's Brock Tickle. I ride for the JGR Yoshimura Factory Suzuki Racing Team, and I'm stoked to be back at the races. Planning my comeback to racing was cool to see. I have a lot of support behind me to get me here. FXR stepped up and invested in me, and I'm stoked to be part of them. FXR honestly kind of blew me away. All the product is awesome. The pants fit me awesome. The best fitting pant I've ever worn, and everything's supplemented, and it looks good.
Welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show, presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing, here with Derek Drake. So we've been chatting about the gear and the different stuff with Troy Lee. Do you get to like go through the showroom and just get all the casual clothes you want and stuff? Because I mean, that's a big part of his business too, and I'm sure that's a good perk.
Yeah, definitely. Like all of his casual stuff is also pretty dialed, but like the showroom is kind of like off, like it's not off limits, but it's like
you have to do it from the warehouse, right?
Yeah, so they have to get it. When the warehouse was at TLD Corona, like I would go in and grab a couple shirts and be pumped. But now it's kind of like the showroom's for the showroom, so like you got to order it from the warehouse and it's got to come to the shop. So a little different than what it used to be, but still, like I'll text Jesse and be like, yeah, just send me what you want. And
yeah,
sick.
That's cool. And then obviously, you know, you do a lot of cycling and they've got this whole, I think, I could be wrong, but I think Troy does more business selling mountain bike gear than moto gear. But
yeah,
I mean, the options there are pretty awesome too, right?
Yeah, like any mountain bike needs, like I'll just hit up Jesse and he'll have me kitted. But yeah, the mountain bike scene, I never really knew how big it was and how big Troy was in mountain bike stuff. But yeah, like I watched downhill mountain biking, I'm like, oh, all right, like, yeah, it's pretty big, so.
You know, it's really eye-opening. Have you been to Snow Summit yet to go goof around the downhill court?
Yeah,
dude, it's like 4 out of 5 people are there kidding Troy Lee. Mm-hmm. It's pretty amazing.
Yeah, definitely.
All right, so you mentioned Max a little bit earlier, right? So does he work at Troy Lee now?
No, he's riding. He had his little, I think, AC, I don't know
injured.
What he did.
He
yeah, his injury to his knee, and then just recently did something to his thumb or hand, and he had to get surgery on that. So he's kind of, I don't know if he's back on the bike yet, but he should be close. But I think he's starting to ride again and get back into the swing of things.
Mm-hmm. Is he going for his like pro points and all that?
I don't know. I haven't talked to him about it. It would be cool though.
Yeah. Okay. So looking forward to the summer and the outdoors and everything. I mean, you've got one national series under your belt already, right? So it's got to be a big help or like put you at ease mentally to know all the tracks, right?
Yeah, definitely. All my whole rookie season last year, I remember just like when I was leaving the track, I'm like, dang, like I wish I could do it one more time. Now that I know the track, I'm like, I just wish I could just do the day over again, know what I know now, and it'd be a lot better. But that's the whole point of being a rookie and learning the tracks, learning the whole system, and pretty much just learning how gnarly and aggressive it is. Like, it's crazy.
Yeah. What was your best showing last year?
I think like a tenth.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Where was that at?
I got one at Hangtown and then another at Washougal. Yeah.
Both West Coast tracks, huh?
Yeah.
I imagine you've ridden Hangtown plenty of times in your life, right?
Yeah, definitely. Hangtown's one of my home tracks. From like where I grew up, Hangtown was 4 hours north and Glen Helen was 4 hours south. So both those tracks were my home tracks, I guess.
It's so funny to hear you go, 4 hours, like 4 hours is nothing big deal, right?
Yeah. We drove that a lot.
what track was the most surprising for you, like to get to, and just, was there anything where like the jumps were way bigger than you thought they're gonna be, or the track was way rougher?
I would say High Point, like how, like the elevation and
the
off cambers and like TV. I've been watching that race for years and years on TV, and it's nothing like what it is in person. Like, dude, like the downhill rollers and how like gnarly, rutty and muddy it is, and just the off cambers and how deep the ruts are at High Point. It's crazy.
Mm-hmm. Okay, you know, you're here now, you're a pro. What's the most surprising thing about being a professional like factory rider to you, like that you didn't expect?
I mean, luckily for me, I've had this team behind me for 4 years, and I've kind of been groomed for this. And since I was an amateur, like I would go to the race shop and I'd see McRath's bike, I'd see like Oldenburg's bike, and I would see all the bikes there. So it wasn't a scary jump at all for me. It was really mellow, and I hopped on the pro bike and I felt at ease right away. And I mean, it was relatively easy transitioning, but.
What about like commitments or media things that you have to do? Like, you know, all the, you have to go get filmed for the Supercross intros and everything. Like, Is there a lot more to it than you expected?
Yeah, definitely. Like the media day that they host like 2 weeks before Anaheim, like that's a lot. I knew nothing about that. So that was a surprise for me and all the what they talk about. And that was a surprise for sure. And that's probably really another surprise was the stadiums, just how big and how crazy it is mm-hmm. that they put a track in the middle of it and you gotta go race it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's the biggest drag about being a pro racer? I love riding my motorcycle, mm-hmm. right? And but there's times when it's I already rode three times this week. I don't want to ride anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
Is that the worst? Like you have to do it even when you don't feel
yeah.
like
it? I would say so. Like getting the just the drag of riding four times a week during the preseason mountain bike rides and all that stuff. I mean, it gets tough, but you have to remind yourself all right, it's my job. If I don't show up, I can't not show up. I have to show up
can't
and do my work
today.
And do it as best I can. But then another drag is the traveling.
Yeah.
Luckily for me, I'm on the West Coast this year and it's not bad, but outdoors last year, my rookie season, I was hurting when I got home. I'm like, oh my God, we gotta go fly back to New York again. Or Michigan or whatever. And so that was kind of a drag, but I think this summer we're gonna spend some time out in Florida. I'm not sure yet, but that's been in the workings.
Yeah.
So traveling from Florida for the East Coast races won't be that bad. So it'll make it a lot better.
And I think the being based there and the heat and humidity is definitely an advantage when you get to a hot race, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Not very humid out here in California.
No, it's just the dry. I mean, last summer it's got pretty hot days, but it's just dry, hot weather. But Florida, you got that humidity, and so it kills you.
Yeah. All right, in closing, so we talked about Supercross goals. Where do you see yourself this summer? What will please you?
I would say top fives for sure during the outdoor season. I've had more experience in outdoors. I've been doing that my whole life, so I want to knock off a couple top fives.
Yeah, right on. Well, I think you can do it for sure. Thanks for coming on, Derek.
Thank you.
All righty. So, guys, follow Derek Drake on Instagram. I think it's at Derek Drake underscore, right?
Yeah.
What's with the underscores?
Derek Drake is taken. He's got five followers or something. So I was like, oh, who is this? So I had to put an underscore down there. So to make it mine.
All right. And then obviously bookmark swapmotolive.com on your web browser. And thanks for watching. We'll see you next week.